I don't know what to believe anymore. Vision is Mephisto, Hayward is Mephisto, Agnes is Mephisto, you're Mephisto, I'm Mephisto. Not everyone is Mephisto, okay? I'm beginning to think that Mephisto isn't even remotely involved in the series at all. But that's it. That's the tweet.
Unleash hell, demon spawn!
Okay, so Evan Peters is Mephisto. Hello, my name is Brandon, and I don't really have time for the formalities. Episode 6 of WandaVision set up so much for the future of Marvel that I am overwhelmingly overwhelmed. Not only is this setting things up for Spider-Man 3 and Doctor Strange and Secret Invasion and Captain Marvel 2, but possibly Loki and possibly the Young Avengers and possibly Kang the effing Conqueror? I'll come back to all of this, but firstly, I must issue your one and only spoiler warning. To be fair, you shouldn't have even clicked on the video if you're not caught up to speed on WandaVision. See what I did there? Right off the bat, our previously on segment gives us our first look at Aaron Taylor Johnson since his appearance in Avengers Age of Ultron. Listen, I don't know how Marvel's contracts work, but if I had to guess, seeing his face is a strong indication that we will see his face reappear at some point in this show. At least I hope so. Maybe a flashback sequence, something along those lines. I would imagine that they would have to pay him for his appearance in this episode, unless their contract extends to a point where they can use his image from any past movie that he's been in for any future project. I don't know. I'm not a lawyer. But we were left with a very important question at the end of last week's episode. Who are you and what have you done with Pietro?
Wanda, you got some splaining to do.
Was that question answered during this week's episode? What do you think? But I do have some guesstimations on why we are seeing Evan Peters' version of the character as opposed to the OG Quicksilver we saw in Avengers. I've narrowed it down to a few possibilities. One, whoever brought Pietro back didn't do their research very well and grabbed the wrong one. Maybe Wanda did by accident. Or whoever did it did their research and grabbed a Pietro that existed in the 1980s to fit with the time of the sitcom reality, which just so happens to be the Fox X-Men Quicksilver. This would be an interesting way of explaining how he got there, physically opening the door to the possibility of the multiverse and mutants to enter the MCU. They're literally teasing us.
Don't sweat it, sis. I got the old XY chromosome.
I mean, XY chromosome? Listen, I know what an XY chromosome is, but it's definitely a blatant reference. Feige knows what he's doing. Option two is that this is Pietro. Evan Peters claims he was the same brother that was shot dead in the street and simply woke up in Wanda's reality.
I got shot like a chump in the street for no reason at all, and next thing I know, I heard you calling me. I knew you needed me.
If that's the last thing that you remember, then explain this.
Don't sweat it, sis. It's not like your dead husband could die twice.
Yeah, how did you know that Vision died, seeing as he didn't die until 2 years after you did?
You nasty.
Option three, which is the one that I'm leaning on, is that this is some other entity inhabiting Pietro's body to gain Wanda's trust and sort of ease her conscience for the wrongdoings that she's committed, even giving her his approval for the hostage situation she created in Westview to make her feel better about her decision, to make her feel okay being the villain. But I think that Wanda suspects the intrusion.
What happened to your accent?
What happened to yours?
Babaloo?
When Pietro reminisces about their time as kids in Sokovia, Wanda claims she remembers it differently, only for Pietro to deflect it back to her, saying that she's suppressing her memories. Are you sure you didn't do that, sir, whoever you are? When Wanda asks about their childhood later, Pietro deflects again, instead taking the kids for a speed run of Candy Crush and to kick ass.
Kick ass?
Kick ass? Good one. I know yins are tired of hearing about the Mephisto theories, but I honestly do think that Pietro is a manifestation of Mephisto. I mean, come on.
Unleash hell, demon spawn!
And look at that hair, for God's sake. I know it's a reference to his look in the comics, but that hair is mighty pointy, sort of resembling horns.
Ladies and gentlemen, we got him.
And Mephisto doesn't have to be the only villainous entity at play here. He could be working with Agnes, whoever Agnes might be. Agatha Harkness. Or somebody else entirely. Maybe he's working with Nightmare, another well-known villain of Doctor Strange. All of these background players could be working together to ensure that Wanda keeps her eyes on the prize. The prize for Wanda is to have a suburban life with Vision. But for them, it could be her hex magic, tricking her into continuing to use her magic. And as we see at the end of the episode, expand her reality bubble. But let's think about this again. In episode 1, Arthur presses the questions, which forces Wanda to redress the set. In episode 2, the town convinces Wanda to have kids.
For the children.
In episode 3, the stork, wherever that stork came from, points out that Monica is an intruder. Then Wanda sees a dead Vision, which reminds her that she can't have this life outside of this bubble. Then in the 80s episode, we see Agnes being very fishy with the dead dog. And then Pietro arrives to stir things up. Then in this episode, Wanda sees a dead Pietro as another reminder of the life that she can't have. And then that jab about her husband can't die twice, he's just provoking her, causing her to lash out and expand the barrier. All of this could be to have Wanda grow stronger, so whoever is behind the curtain can feed on her magic until she withers away.
Snacked on yo magic, bro.
And I feel like Billy can sense the intrusion. He has an irrational fear of his Uncle Pete right off the bat, being compared to a vampire. And Billy has telepathic abilities, which we see him use to find Vision later. And even earlier, we see him use his powers to train Sparky when he holds the treat up to his temple. His powers could have given him a warning of the impending doom. Pietro is definitely a threat, and he's not to be trusted. I haven't fully ruled out Agnes yet either. When Vision approaches her nearing the barrier of Westview, what is she doing out that way anyway? It's almost like she was set there as a preventative measure in case Vision ventured too far. Because at this point, Wanda already knows that he's snooping around. And Agnes appears to be the only one with a cognitive reciprocation to respond to Vision before he awakens her. And as soon as he does, she immediately points the blame back to Wanda.
No one leaves. Wanda won't even let us think about it.
And where is her pendant? This is the first time that we see her without it. Either it's a misdirection leading up to this point, or there's another reason for it, and I'm just not quite sure what that is yet. This could all be the classic Marvel villain trope, similar to that of the Hellfire Club. Because anytime they try to awaken the Phoenix Force, they are quickly overwhelmed by its power. Maybe Agnes helped Wanda create this reality, and much like anyone that was in the close vicinity, was quickly consumed by the chaos. And she was just simply unaware of the level of power that she wielded. And what happens when the bubble gets too big? Like Monica suggests, what happens if Wanda dies? Does the bubble continue to expand? Will it expand until it pops, consuming anything in its path, like Darcy and the rest of the Sword Agents? To be fair, they were starting to act like clowns anyway, so it fits.
I work here.
If you did, your badge would work, wouldn't it?
Let it get me down.
These swords will take you straight into town.
Cause this fine old world, it keeps spinning around. I've been a puppet up called...
But this Halloween-themed special episode definitely pays homage to Malcolm in the Middle. The kids are the primary focus of the episode, talking directly to the camera. And Pietro is basically Reese, and the opening theme is basically a ripoff of Malcolm's theme. But listen to the words.
Don't try to fight the chaos. Don't question what you've done. The game can try to play us.
More brainwashing from whatever entity is at play here, as a message to stop fighting back and just embrace the chaos. And even though the music of the episode and the Halloween setting gives us our comic accurate suits, trying to be cute, there's 100% something sinister brewing beneath the surface. And with the kids being front and center this episode, we get to see their powers bloom. Something I didn't think we'd see quite yet, but also something that is setting the stage for the young Avengers. But I'll come back to that, because I can't quite get over how tragic of a character Vision has become. I mean, being called insults like popsicle, toaster, walking computer.
Let me guess. Traffic light.
He's just trying so desperately to find answers and to see how far Wanda's mind control goes, if it's even Wanda's. He even has to lie to continue playing the part of the loyal husband so that he's able to get away, because she won't let him leave.
Vision, are you not letting me leave?
Oh, how the turntables. And now it's Wanda's turn preventing Vision from leaving. Is this revenge? It's pretty petty if you ask me. Unless Wanda is protecting Vision from Sword, very similar to how Vision was protecting Wanda from the Sokovia Accords. And the further that Vision strays from Wanda, the simulation starts to crumble. Little does Vision know that he needs Wanda and her reality bubble to stay alive. But Wanda is losing control. I mean, The Incredibles and The Parent Trap playing at the same time? An amazing double feature, don't get me wrong, but that's a pretty significant leap in release dates. Maybe this is trying to tell us something? The Incredibles, or rather the best Fantastic Four movie we've ever had. That or it's just a nod to this new super family. And The Parent Trap is a commentary on the two twins reuniting and hiding their accents. On the outside of the Hex bubble, Hayward continues to be a pretty big tool, basically firing Monica, Wu, and Darcy from assisting Sword because they're sticking up for for Wanda. Hey, I'm with you guys. I don't think she's the villain either. But Hayward, on the other hand, he certainly sounds like one.
Maybe it's a good thing you weren't here when your mother died, because clearly you don't have the stomach for this job.
Could Hayward be a Skrull in disguise, setting the stage for Captain Marvel 2 and Secret Invasion? We saw Fury on a ship full of Skrulls at the end of Spider-Man Far From Home, which we thought was part of S.W.O.R.D. It still could be. Fury trusts the Skrulls, though, so if Hayward is a Skrull, he's one of the bad ones that we're so familiar with in the comics. And if he is, it'll be up to our new cast of Two Broke Girls to save the day.
The energy inside has rewritten your cells on a molecular level twice. It's changing you.
Season premiere, CBS next Monday.
At least they'll have an easy time going up against him whenever those photon or spectrum powers decide to make their debut. But we can't leave out Jimmy, seeing as how he's able to kick some serious ass. And the more I see this trio get shit done, the more I really want an Agents of Atlas show. Or an X-Files-like series hunting down multiverse anomalies or even mutants. Even if Hayward isn't a Skrull, in my eyes, he's still a dick.
Terrorists.
When Vision breaks out of the Westview barrier, he falls to literal pieces in front of S.W.O.R.D., and it's right where Hayward wants him, back in his possession. But why? For what? What is the Cataract Weapons Project that Hayward was so keen on keeping a secret? It probably has something to do with why Vision was torn apart in that lab. They were probably weaponizing him. And it's a stretch, but maybe they were analyzing Vision's robotics to get a head start on the Sentinel program. S.W.O.R.D. could be our new Trask Industries, thus tying this all together to the mutants and the X-Men. But that's why Wanda rescued him, to revitalize him and to give them a new life. This is all very similar to the West Coast Avengers and Vision Quest story arcs. Wanda saves Vision in a very similar manner from a government facility, and helps bring him back to life as the White Vision. But there is a much, much grander scheme at play in that story. One that involves the time-traveling warlord Kang the Conqueror. But here's the thing. Jonathan Majors has been cast as Kang in the upcoming Ant-Man threequel, and is even rumored to appear in the upcoming Loki series, where it seems Loki will be assisting the TVA, or the Time Variance Authority, whose job is to monitor and correct the time stream. And with the Avengers screwing up the multiverse so bad in Avengers Endgame, there are expected to be some unforeseen consequences. And I'm willing to bet that Kang is one of them.
You'll see.
Kang, or rather his future self, Immortus, is both fascinated and afraid of Wanda's powers, seeing as how she is a Nexus-level being. A Nexus is an insanely powerful being with powers and capabilities of altering the timeline and destiny of the universe. Kang has been known to try and prevent Wanda's powers from altering reality, even going so far as to try and hunt down her kids, seeing as how they are a manifestation of her abilities, but ultimately failing in the end. In some cases, Kang's younger self, Iron Lad, actually assists the twins in forming the Young Avengers to stop Kang, to stop himself. I know, it's a lot. This might be where the MCU is headed, though. We know Kang is coming, so with Speed and Wiccan in WandaVision, Hailee Steinfeld set to appear as Kate Bishop in the Hawkeye series, Catherine Newton cast as Cassie Lang or Stature in Ant-Man Quantumania, America Chavez will be played by Sochi Gomez in Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness, Patriot is rumored to appear in Falcon and the Winter Soldier, and with possibilities of Hulkling and Kid Loki appearing in future projects, then we are definitely getting a new Avengers team for the next generation. WandaVision or Doctor Strange could end with Wanda muttering those irreversible words, similar to that of No More Mutants, but instead could be No More Avengers, thus wiping away our current roster of Avengers from existence, leaving it up to a newer, fresher, younger Avengers team to bring them back and save the day. What am I supposed to do with myself until the next episode? I could read more and go for a run. It's cold out. I don't really have too many winter clothes that could keep me warm on a run like that. I guess I could find something on Netflix. If you like hearing me talk about WandaVision, be sure to subscribe. I'll be reviewing every upcoming episode, hopefully the day that they're released. I even plan to continue doing this when Falcon and the Winter Soldier drops next month, so be sure to stick around. Also, keep your eye out over on twitch.tv/boxthewise. I plan to hop over there to play some video games here soon once I fix Bessie here. Also, follow me over on Twitter. Come yell at me over there about WandaVision and all of my crazy theories. It certainly would be better than tweeting into the void. Thanks for stopping by. And until next time, I'm going to submerge myself in a wallowing pity until the next episode comes out. Goodbye!
Thanks a lot. Bye.